Okay, so hi. So okay, let's get started. Well, that's not what we're supposed to do. Okay, so basically, when you see someone, you know, doing a framework or an engine in this case, it's because it's a person that has experience doing many similar applications in the same domain, and from all that experience, you can abstract it into a framework and make reusable stuff. And in the case of a 3D engine, you expect pretty much the same. Someone that has done lots of 3D application or used different frameworks, and you know, from that experience, you build something that is somehow better. So I'm sorry to disappoint you, but that's not my case. So actually, my case is that I'm doing this to learn 3D stuff. So basically, let me tell you a little bit about the project lifetime. So first, time I started to do this was in 2005 when I was doing my undergrad thesis, and the idea was to have this 3D world stuff for teaching object-oriented programming, and well, for many reasons it failed, so I kind of freeze it. Then later in 2007 I was doing some research for my PhD thesis, and we were doing, you know, taking cartographies from the city and building 3D worlds on top of that, and the idea was to kind of put pictures in this 3D environment, and then suddenly Street View appear from Google, and we say, okay, there's no way of doing this because these guys have lots of money, lots of people, and doing definitely better than we're doing. So then it was frozen again. From then on, it kind of started as a spare time project, so I'm trying to keep it alive by doing that. And basically, as I told you, building this 3D engine is about learning about 3D stuff, which I like, but to be honest with you, before doing this, I never did any 3D applications, so it's definitely learning from this. And basically, here Smalltalk is for me a tool and just basically a live documentation of what I know. So I learn something and then I just go and code it. And of course, it can have many mistakes because my knowledge, you know, is pretty reduced. So as I go learning, I go doing stuff. And of course, the advantage that I have no deadlines, no pressures. It's definitely fun, and I can explore different stuff and tools, and I'll show you later. But of course, you get to do many and really, really, really many redesigns, because each time you learn something new, you say, okay, this was completely bad design, and you have to, you know, redo everything again. And sometimes go weeks or months between, you know, the different changes, because you don't get time, because work or whatever. So, you know, advantages and disadvantages of taking this path. So basically, what I want to show you is the things I learned in this process, and tell you about the tools I used, which were good, which were bad, and some design decisions. And many things are going to be covered really, really, really in the surface. I'm really sorry about that, but it's like time is a constraint now, so some things are going to be, you know, not explained in depth. So basically, about this engine, I really don't care about the latest fancy 3D stuff. I just want to get the roots of and understand what's going on with 3D. The hardware I got in this machine, the 3D hardware is really crappy, so it's just an Intel on board, so I wanted to do something that I could play with, so basically it's very low hardware requirements, just OpenGL 1.1 I guess, so something very simple, and something that would be easy to grasp for a newcomer, so that like you just, you know, grab it and use it, and try to keep it as simple as I can. So basically, what is OpenGL anyway? OpenGL is just a library, you know, it's portable across multiple operating systems, and you get just 2D and 3D graphic stuff. And it's based on a huge, really huge state machine, so basically think of it as an API wrote in C style that you just send commands, and those commands are changing the state, the current state of this machine. And it has lots of constants around, you know, 2,500, something like that. So imagine that you have this function that takes three parameters, and two of them are, you know, enumerations, and maybe the first one has, I don't know, 10 possibilities, and the other one has 15 possibilities, and you get all this, you know, stuff that for C people is really, really, really what they are used to, but for us, it's like, okay, I had to write a message for each combination of this one, and it becomes kind of a nightmare. So another thing that you should know is that basically OpenGL, what does is you give 3D information and it takes care of putting it in your screen, right? So you are working there in 2D. So basically you got the X and Y axis in the standard way, but you know what does the Z axis mean? And basically what you do is you have your screen in front of you, you know, the negative axis Z goes that way and the positive goes like coming to you. So basically that's the way that OpenGL understands the space. And so let me show you just a little example. So, you know, the first sentence there is say, okay, begin triangles. So this is one of the functions I told you that takes a constant. So basically what I say is change your state to drawing triangles, okay? And all the vertexes that I'm putting there is basically, okay, you're going to build a triangle by using these vertexes. And each time you call here a function, what you're doing is basically changing the underlying state. And as you can see, before each vertex, I'm assigning a color. So basically, once you finish doing your triangle drawing, what it says, okay, okay, this vertex and this color, this color, this vertex, this color, this vertex, and I have to make a triangle of this. And basically, what OpenGL understands is that it has to blend these colors because each vertex has a different one. So what you get basically is that triangle. Okay, what does OpenGL do? Well, basically, it handles primitives like line, points, polygons, some surfaces, etc. It handles the view and transformation. So it's okay, if I'm standing here and I have a point that is far, far away, then it's going to be shown small. And if it's very near the camera, then it's going to be big. So that kind of stuff is taken care of by OpenGL. It handles things like, you know, textures, taking an image and putting it inside a polygon so that you can, you know, rotate it and whatever. It handles blending of colors, as I showed you kind of recently. Transparency up to a certain point. I will show you later a problem with the way the transparent or semi-transparent objects are rendered. So you got a glass here, you got an object in back. So how are those colors blend to get you the idea that, you know, it's semi-transparent stuff? And many, many, many other things that won't be covered here. Now, what are the things that OpenGL doesn't handle? And the first thing is that since it is platform independent, it's logical to think that it doesn't handle things that are operating system dependent, like creating windows and handling, you know, the keyboard at low level and other stuff. So there are other libraries like Glut that take care of that. You also have no concept of what a scene is because you don't even have objects, right? You are just sending commands to a state machine. So there is no camera, there is no scene, there is no anything, just commands. So that's why rendering engines appear. It doesn't handle physics, you know, like, say, I put this here and there's gravity and it falls down to the ground. Well, that is not going to be handled by OpenGL. No collision detection or whatever. So all this stuff is are engines or libraries that are built on top of OpenGL and they are used to get all these effects. And, of course, sound is not handled. So when I started with this, I just thought in, you know, as a complete way. So I say, okay, I'm going to do a rendering engine for OpenGL. And it was like everything was one big layer. And then I realized that that was not very healthy for the system and it was quite a nightmare to maintain it. So I kind of split it into layers. And the idea, the basic idea, and which when I realized it had to be done that way, I say, okay, that's the way we are used to do this. And I say, okay, let's first of all model in Smalltalk the OpenGL machinery. Of course, I cannot reproduce it all because it would be a really huge model. And in most of the time, it would be a waste of resources. But basically, what I want is to have a class that represents the underlying OpenGL model, and, well, basically a global variable that has the only instance of it. And the other thing that this layer should handle are the rendering surfaces. Rendering surfaces are dependent of the operating system, the way you create them. And, you know, I'm doing this in VisualWorks, and VisualWorks is, you know, platform independent. So you have to create all this strategy stuff and creating classes for each particular platform and so on. So the idea is that basically what I'm doing here is something very similar to that library Glut I told you, so that you can create inside VisualWorks just, okay, give me this rendering surface and I want to draw on it. I want it to be thread safe because OpenGL is thread safe when you have native operating system processes, but we know that Smalltalk handles, you know, processes like green threads. So if you have two threads writing to the same inside the same process, OpenGL doesn't take care of that, so we have to be thread safe. And I didn't want in this layer to add any kind of high-level construct, so I'm really, at this point, sticking to all these methods with constants as parameters, and not yet abstracting that. So just to give you an example of how, what is the Smalltalk version of that very first example I show you, so I'm saying, okay, be active while to a rendering surface, this is the primitive stuff, and this is what actually gives us thread safe, because I have a mutex in there, so that block is the only way to execute code from OpenGL. And well, that is clearing the background, which wasn't in the previous example, but it should have been. So I say, okay, begin triangle. So I'm getting just sometimes a little degree of abstraction, so I'm not saying begin constant triangles, but it could have been. And now, you see, just by programming Smalltalk, you start taking the advantages of it, because, for example, you know, now I can say color by red because this is already implemented, and instead of saying all this ugly stuff. So I'm just, by modeling stuff in Smalltalk, I'm just getting higher level of abstraction. And finally, I'm swapping buffers because this is a double buffer rendering stuff. So anyway, it should have been also in the previous example, I just didn't want to. But so I get this one. Pretty nice. It's basically the same that we got. The first one was white background. This is black, but it's basically the same. So another thing that isn't very compatible between OpenGL and Smalltalk is the way that errors are handled. So if you somehow mess up while calling, you know, all these commands, sending to the OpenGL machinery, what does OpenGL do? Well, basically, it just takes the command that are causing the error and completely discards them. But there's no visible failure. I mean, your program keeps running. So that's the way that OpenGL has of, I guess, of you know, having all these different programs accessing the same machinery and no breaking everything. So basically, except you have an out-of-memory error, maybe you get this undefined behavior that also Andres was talking about. So maybe except for an out-of-memory error, your program just keeps running. The thing is that you start to see weird things because things are not rendered or they are rendered in the bad way. Okay. So basically, the way that you have to know if there was an error is calling glgetError, which is very similar to the getLastError of Windows and that stuff. And it, you know, it gets you the last error, and then it clears the error flag. And the recommendation in the Red Book is basically the Bible of OpenGL. It was written a long, long time ago. And it's to call glgetError at least once in each display routine. So just to give you an idea, a display routine may, I don't know, issue 10,000 commands. It's a pretty normal stuff in a 3D scene that are going to be rendered. So you have to call this once with 10,000 commands and try to see what the error is. So that kind of doesn't fit in the kind of model that we want. So basically, how do we solve this gap between Smalltalk exceptions and OpenGL errors? Well, at least for me, I thought that there was a clean, nice way to do it. That is using wrappers and basically, you know, wrapping the OpenGL model and reifying the errors of OpenGL, which are actually only 7 errors in exceptions. And we get something like that, but using doesn't understand, and just each time I call a primitive, then I get to check the errors. So even though this one is actually not high performance, because you don't want this in your production environment, it's really, really handy when you're working, you know, debugging stuff. And basically, as you can see here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you an example. So this example, you see the square here, but there's nothing draw here. And actually, debugging is off. Now I'm turning this on, and I get this exception, and if I debug it, I can see, well, here's the proxy, if that's not understand, and the problem was here when I'm saying GLN, because I'm ending the triangle, and basically what I did here is I started a triangle, but in the middle I started a polygon without closing the triangle, so that's what's causing the error. So now you can see it, and of course debug it, and whatever. And again, if I turn this off, then you see no error, you just don't see the triangle. Okay, so basically, this low-level layer just handles this basic 4 stuff. OpenGL machinery, rendering surfaces, is thread-safe, and there are no high-level constructs. So, let's get to the point. Now, I'm going to talk about all this stuff, and I guess I will run out of time, so pardon me if I go somehow fast. So basically, a rendering context is an abstraction, just a little bit higher level, that is still state-oriented, but it's kind of a, you know, dedicated OpenGL model that I'm getting a surface. So I'm associating a surface with an OpenGL model, and I'm providing higher-level primitives. So something that you would do, like material for a constant, attribute, another constant, a value. So I kind of start reifying all this stuff so that I can get rid of all the constant and have meaningful messages. And the viewport is basically what allows you to see the scene, and it's kind of a widget version of an OpenGL surface. So you can just, you know, integrate an OpenGL surface with the standard MVC widget stuff. And of course, for each widget, we have a rendering context. And basically, when viewports ask by the framework to be displayed, it switches to the rendering stuff. And basically, rendering is taking the surface and being active while the camera sets the environment, and the scene is rendered in the rendering context, and then we swap the buffers, and we got it running. So let's get a bit into OpenGL. So OpenGL has basically 10 primitives for drawing geometric stuff, and they are defined in constant from glbegin, so they are all the primitives over there. And basically, all the specification of the vertex is the same. The only thing that changed is the initial state. Remember, again, we are always talking about a state machine. So here I'm saying, okay, begin drawing triangles. I'm sending all these vertex. So by the time I end sending these commands, the OpenGL machinery understands that it has to draw triangles like over here. But if instead of that I say, okay, start drawing lines, then these four commands are going to be interpreted as two lines. So we get something like this kind of stuff. Okay, so the easy part is to say, okay, take each primitive, reify it as an object, create an object for this, and we start moving out of the state-oriented to the object-oriented world. And one of the nice things is that, as I told you, in OpenGL, you know, the error stuff is handled in a weird way. So, for example, if you say, I get a triangle, and instead of sending three vertexes, you send four vertexes, that four vertex is lost. You know, it's wrong because if you send six vertexes, then you have two triangles. If you send three, you have one. But if you send four, what do you get? Well, it's kind of undefined. Actually, it's pretty much defined. You just draw a triangle with the first three, and the fourth is thrown. But you, the developer, would never know what has happened, actually, that there was kind of error. So one of the added values of starting to move into the object-oriented world is that when we get the collection with the vertexes, we can check the size and see if it's accurate for the kind of primitive that we are wanting to draw. So now we get to write this kind of stuff, okay, on a polygon with this collection of vertexes. And things say, okay, this is really easy, really simple. And then things start to become not that simple because then you start to have rasterization modes. Okay, how do I want to render this stuff? As lines, as points, polygons, fill polygons, line polygon? Do I want to have it just a plain color? So, I mean, this polygon is red. Or then I can have more complex materials that, you know, you say, okay, I want the light. Well, you have different types of light, diffuse light, ambient light, and different kind of stuff that I'm not going to get into because it's a subject on itself. But you can work just with plain colors or with materials that are affected by light. Okay, so these are more complex specifications. And you can have both type of objects in the same scene. So some of them working without lighting and some of them working with lighting. And then you get textures that you can put, you know, textures and an image inside a polygon, for example. And then you can also make specification, not at the object level, but at the vertex level, like I show in the triangle when we say, okay, I want this vertex blue, this vertex red, and this vertex green, and you do the blending in between. So this is kind of simple in the state-oriented because, okay, you're just sending commands, so you have to decide when to send each command. But when you move to the object-oriented world, well, it was kind of a pain to move that stuff. So basically what I ended up doing was kind of thinking of separating the structure from presentation. So an object basically is about, a primitive is about knowing the vertexes you have and how is this physically composed, and then you can put skin on it. So basically the skin is the one in charge of handling, you know, the mode that's working with, or the texture that's applied, the material, and of course, we get some benefits that skins can be mixed, as I'm going to show you, and that it can be composed and create composites. So what we get here is, let me show you this. Oh, I don't think you're going to see, I don't know, can you see that back there? Code? Well, basically what I'm doing here is just creating a line and assigning a material to it and saying, okay, I want the width to be 3, and in this case I'm doing enabling the anti-aliasing, and you can see that over here. So these two lines, as you can see, this one should be kind of shaggy over here and this one is aliased, but I don't think that the projector is good enough to show that. So we can create composite of skins, and we can say, okay, I want this to be filled with a green value and have points dotted with a red of a diameter of 4. So basically what I'm having here are all these different objects that have these composite skins. You know, one is filled with dots, all is filled and has a border, and, well, you know, combining all of them. I can mix stuff. So basically this one here, it's filled with a material that, you know, it's rendered according to light. It's pretty basic because just gray, but it has all these parameters of how the light's affected. And the border here is just plain blue. So if we have a light here, and if we could have this shiny material that, you know, reflects light, but the lines over here would be just drawn without caring about light. We can also, well, do by vertex specification. That was pretty much the first example. And what I'm doing here is I'm creating, you know, this material that is going to be used for a vertex. And then I'm creating a vertex, not just a point, which has a location, a position, and a material. And what I'm saying here is that this triangle has a vertex-dependent material. So that's why it's rendered that way. And then, of course, we can have, you know, textures applied to objects. So this is basically simple box stuff. Okay, so far so good? Yeah? So let's keep talking about OpenGL. One of the things that OpenGL doesn't have, again, because a state machine, is, you know, the abstraction of what a camera is. So basically OpenGL provides two functions. One is the possibility to look at something when you say, okay, I'm standing here, I'm going to look in that kind of direction, and what up means. So here, as you can see, up is kind of a vector at 45 degrees, so that kind of allows you to roll your camera. And the other thing that you can say is what's the projection that you're using, and in 3D worlds, we basically use a frustum that's a truncated pyramid. And what you specify is what near means, what far means, and what are, you know, the parts of the pyramid, and anything inside this part will be rendered, and what is outside here won't. So pretty trivial. We have the concept of a camera in the framework, which, well, has a position, direction, and all the stuff. And you also have a series of volumes that are, you know, the frustum, a bounding box, which is an axis aligned box that encompasses this frustum, and also a bounding sphere that will be used later. And basically what you can do now is stuff like this, and create a projection, and create a camera, and of course you can give behavior to the camera, say, okay, move this way, move that way, and go forward, go backward, so you start to have more behavior associated to it. And basically what a camera does is, well, this load mode VOD is just some stuff that you have to do to clear kind of the state. You say, okay, I'm starting fresh, and I'm kind of changing the world to match what my camera says. And then I say, well, the clipping volume of this rendering context is going to be my volume, because I have my volume, and I know what is the part of the scene that I can render. So basically, having a scene as a object container, what we get is that when we render a scene, we are basically rendering all the components. The question that arises is, okay, how should I update my scene? When should the scene be rendered again? And of course you say, okay, when the model view controller framework tells you to render it, you know, that I showed you that display on was changed to render, of course, but then if the objects in the scene change, then you need to update your scene. So basically, you have one approach that is having a constant frame rate. That's okay. I have a background process, and I don't know, every 20 milliseconds, my scene is going to be rendered again. So the thing is that if no changes are happening in the scene, you are basically redrawing the scene unnecessary and keeping processor use in other, maybe more important stuff. So the other thing that you can say, okay, each time an object changes, I have all these, observer pattern implemented, and each time an object changes, then you get a change and you redraw the scene. The problem is, think of a burst of, 100 objects changing, and if each time you receive a change, you redraw, then you will be redrawing this many times, and you might actually even see artifacts like one object moving and the other one not. So basically, it's not really useful to do that. So you can kind of combine both of them, and having this process running in background at a given frames per second, you say, okay, I want this to be rendered at 60 frames per second, so you have this process running in background and one each 16 milliseconds to render again. But it will only render if there's a queue of changes, and if in that queue there's at least one change. So basically what you're doing is, in that time frame that you say, okay, I have to be ill 16 milliseconds, you wait and you just kind of compact all the changes that happen in that period of time and show them. This approach also has its disadvantages, but well, it was kind of the better compromise that I could get. And this, of course, has the coupling and rendering strategy, and you can change them and play with them and all the stuff. So, another topic. OpenGL basically provides a way to cache the commands that you send to the same machine. These can be done by the means of this playlist, and basically what you say to OpenGL is, okay, create a display list now, and I'm starting to put you in compile mode, and okay, I'm sending all these commands. So you just compile all these commands, and then you say, okay, I'm done. So basically what OpenGL does is creates all these commands and stores this in theory, in the graphics card memory, so it can be quickly accessed by it. And so the next time that you have to draw your cube, instead of drawing the cube, you just say, okay, OpenGL, please execute this compiled list, and it does. So it's using mainly for speeding up stuff, because it can be done much faster, because not only you don't have to call all this thing by hand, but also because OpenGL stores it in a way that is performant to do it. And well, in this engine, basically caching an object is sending as cached the object to an object that you have already created. So you have a triangle that says, okay, as cached the object, and it's going to handle all this stuff for you. Basically, what the object does is, okay, this is cache. If I am already cached, I'm just asking the displaces to be applied. And if not, I just create it, I put in compile mode, compile everything, and blah. One of the nice things of this approach is that by implementing this observer pattern, the cached object, which is actually a wrapper, is dependent on the object that is caching. So when this object changes, the caching object knows that, and it can, flush the display list and say, okay, I'm not cached anymore. So the next time it starts to render, it's going to recompile everything. So you can have a cached object that has changed, and everything's done automatically, okay? So another thing that is pretty common to have in OpenGL is the transformation stuff. And the basic idea is that, suppose, for example, you're drawing a car, and the car has four wheels. So you can, create four copies of your wheel, but you can have your model stored, kind of in an abstract way. You say, I have this wheel, and actually you take the wheel and you put it, you apply transformations and put it in the four places. So it's actually the same wheel. What you're doing is say, okay, put the wheel in this way and draw it here. Then just rotate the wheel a little bit, move it a little bit here, and then draw again. And what you're doing basically in OpenGL is you're constantly moving your wheel and drawing objects. And this is nice to save memory, because if you have a huge model in memory, then you have to keep it only once, and then you can repeat it four times. And again, using wrappers is a pretty cool stuff. So you get this clone using a transformation message that gives you an object. You can clone it and create a clone of that object, something that when it starts to be rendered, then it's going to, make some stuff with the transformation. Basically applying the transformation before the object is rendered, and then forwarding the original rendering to the object. And of course, transformations can be composable, so you can create these two transformations and create a clone using both of them. Basically, what you're getting here is that there's one triangle that's called triangle one, and you can see them here, that is the same object. And what you're doing is creating two clones of them with two different transformations, okay? But the object is actually only one. So, next subject, animations. As I told you in the framework, I mean, quite a heavy use of the observer pattern, and then it's done by the announcement framework. So you have different kind of announcements for different kind of changes, and then we can exploit them to perform some stuff. I have a really simple animation model, which it has to be changed because it kind of just works for stupid stuff. But the idea is that basically you get the process forked, and you get this, you know, like frame rate that you say, okay, I want this to be updated, 10 times per second or whatever. And you get this template method for specifying each animation step. And the quick way to do this is to be based on transformation, because we can have an object and have transformation, and basically animating is saying, okay, change a bit this transformation, so the angle is just a little bit more than was in the previous frame. So actually what you get is an object turning, for example. And to show you that, this is, you know, kind of the Hello World example for OpenGL, that is the, you know, GLX engine. And basically, what we're going to do here is, this is actually, and something interesting to show you is, when I select an object, I get the bounding box of the selected object. And basically what you can see here is that the clone is okay, but the gear is actually drawn here, the bounding box. And that is because the original object is there. I'm not rendering it there. I'm rendering translated. So that's why I get the clone here, you know, with the bounding box correct. But actually, the object would be here. And what I have done in the middle is caching it, okay? So basically, what I can say here is, okay, tell the animation to start, and it goes okay. And what I'm going to do here in between is, you know, this is the original object, the gear, and it has a skin, and it has a material, and it has all this component here because it's a lighting stuff. So what I'm going to tell this is to change some things. And what has happened here? As you can see, we have a clone. We have a clone over here, and then it's cached, and then the gear. So basically what happened is that I changed the material, then the material changed the skin changed the object was changed, so the object that was caching it got this and flushed the cache, and the next time it was asked to render, it recompiled the object, get a new display list, and it's working cached again, okay? So basically it works. Okay, so I'm almost done. Basically, how does the OpenGL pipeline works? Basically, what you're doing here is, I told you, you are sending comments. So what OpenGL does is, it receives all this vertex data, it has a lot of calculation done per each vertex, and then I told you at the beginning that, you know, in the camera you get a projection, you get a perspective, and basically what OpenGL does is take all these vertexes and say, okay, is this vertex going to be inside my viewing volume? So for example, if I'm standing here and I'm telling OpenGL to render something in the back that I can see, then once all these calculations are done, it's going to say, okay, this vertex is inside the volume node, well, then I'm not going to render it. And there was, well, a lot of stuff going on. Now, the problem here is that if I have this huge scene and I'm sending all these commands, but only a real small portion of them are going to be shown, I'm wasting a lot of time in sending all these commands to the OpenGL. And that's especially true in Smalltalk, because we have, you know, we are bound outside the image, so we have to send these objects from the Smalltalk image to the API and sometimes receive something back, and, you know, this is really, really expensive to do. So basically, and this is known as frustum calling, is to how to you take out things that won't be shown in the scene without actually sending the objects to the scene. And the only important thing here is that this scene object has a skin, and the abstract scene object has these bounding volumes, which is what we are going to be using now. So just for benchmarking purposes, I create this scene with 40,000 triangles that were uniformly distributed in the XZ space, and they are all the same height, same width, and whatever. And the camera is placed in the center, and I'm rendering 200 times the scene. And I wanted to measure the time it took to render and what was the garbage collection activity. So the first approach is like, okay, let's just render them all and see what happens. And basically, what you get is a crappy frame rate that you're displaying things at 11 frames per second. And as you can see, there's a lot of garbage collection going on here. And just for you to know, a decent animation has to have at least 45 frames per second to be smooth. So we only get 11, so that sucks really. Okay. Now, we know that scene objects have bounding boxes. And I know that the camera has its volume. So what I can do is, okay, before sending the object to the pipeline, knowing if, you know, the bounding box of the object intersects the viewing volume of the camera. And notice that I'm saying intersection and not to be inside, because if you only have one portion of the object inside the volume, then you have to send it. So basically we get something. By the way, everything I'm showing here is pseudocode. It's actually not coded that way, but it was kind of a clean way to show you. So basically what you have to do is something like that. So we get some improvements. Now we have 12 scavengers instead of 85, so that's nice. And we kind of double the speed, so now we have 25 frames per second. And the interesting thing here is that 66% of the time is wasted, you know, testing these bounding boxes if they are intersecting or not. And only 22% of the time is actually used in rendering the stuff. And even though it's an improvement, we would like to be the other way around. I mean, we want to spend the time drawing the objects, not calculating stuff between them. So one of the problems is that actually the frustum, as you can see here, this is kind of the projection of the camera and the bounding box that is around it. You know, you have all these places where you can, if you test for intersection, it will be true, but they are actually not intersecting the frustum. So you will say, okay, why you don't test the bounding box of the object against the frustum instead of the actual bounding box of the frustum? And the thing is that testing against a frustum is very expensive, because the way that you model a frustum is like by 6 planes, and then you have to test against each plane, like saying, okay, if you are in the right plane, the point has to be in this side, and on the plane that is on the bottom, it has to be in the upper part, and the plane that's on the top, on the down part. So you have, in the worst case, to make 6 comparisons, and this comparison involves a couple of vector products, so that is very expensive if you compare to just asking for a corner and an origin, which is actually what we do for testing bounding boxes. So the idea is to first you make this gross test against bounding boxes, and if they intersect, then you go and ask to be tested against the frustum. So now the code looks something like this. And we get, okay, 73 scavengers, which is a lot. The last time we have 12. But on the other hand, we are going pretty much in speed, and we're around 33 frames per second. And as you can see, 46% of the time is on the bounding box stuff, 19% of the time in the bounding frustum, and the rest is on the random primitives. So basically, you could just played around with all the different volumes to approximate, and using spheres, using cones, where a cone is actually a way to approximate a frustum. And the truth is, I didn't get much. Things didn't get better, just maybe 1-2%, but nothing. So what has to be changed here is the approach to do this stuff. And there are two basic techniques in the 3D world. One is to have portal engines, and a portal engine, basically the idea is that, for example, if you're modeling this entire building, where we say, okay, this room is a portal, you have these walls, and it is connected to the other room, you know, the hallway there, by means of doors. So if I have this, my frustum looking there, I can render everything here and do the standard frustum calling, but to render the things that are across the door, my frustum kind of shrinks, because I can only see through the door. So in that way, you go shrink in the view. And if I'm looking here and there is no way to, there is no portal to go to the other room, then I just discard all the objects that are behind that wall, okay? Now, the other technique is to organize your space in a hierarchical fashion so that you can very quickly take out large space of objects. And that's done by means of trees, and we will focus on this one because it's a little bit more general than the other one. I mean, there's no better approach here. Each of them has its own, you know, application, particular stuff. So one of the most used techniques is to have an oak tree or a quad tree, and the basic idea is that you get all the objects in your scene, and you start recursively building a tree. So what you do is you split your space in half in these two planes, and it's okay, if I only have one object here, then this is a leaf, and if I have more objects that can be split, then I keep splitting. So you get basically an unbalanced tree like this one. In the case of oak trees, you're working in 3D space, so you have cubes instead of squares, and as you can see, you can have, you know, these smaller cubes over there that are again splitted. On the other hand, our trees, which I had to do for a subject of geographic information systems, these trees are very used for doing stuff in geographic information systems are basically balanced trees. Remember that the previous one was not balanced, and the objects can only be in the leaves, and the intermediate nodes basically only reference other nodes, and they have cached on each node the bounding box of the child. And the idea is so that you can somehow split the objects and create a tree that minimizes the amount of overlapping. So as you can see here, this is a node and has these four leaves. Well, these are nodes. And so here you have an overlapping, and here's small overlapping. But in general, the distribution is pretty nice because, for example, if you want to know which objects intersect this part, you can actually discard this one really fast at the very top level. So some issues with these trees. So when using an oak tree, if you have to split your space in three dimensions in the three axes, what happens if one of your splits cuts the object? So in our case, you know, in that scene that were all those triangles, if you split in the Y and the X vertex, it was okay. But when you cut it in the Z plane, then you're basically cutting all the objects in your scene. So there's no way of splitting that scene. So basically, in the worst case, when you have this recursive algorithm that builds the tree, it would be stuck in the first step because you say, okay, I'm cutting here. How many objects do I cut? 100%. Okay, I cannot cut them, so I stop here. And basically what you get is a linear connection because it cannot split the space. Insertions and deletions are not common here because you assume that you have all the objects and you build the tree. So basically what happens here is that or you rearrange the whole tree or you get really, really unbalanced trees. And the plus is that they are really, really simple to implement. In 2 hours, you can get your oak tree working. And on the other hand, our trees, as I told you, you have to distribute your objects and build your tree in a way that you minimize the overlapping between the bounding boxes. And the thing is that if you try all the combinations, that's exponential time, so you cannot do it. There are heuristics that work pretty nice, and you get like 90-95% of the coverage that you would have in the best case. The implementation is quite hard, really, really hard, I have to say. It took me a lot to get it right, and there were a lot of very, very small bugs that were appearing. So one thing about the oak trees is that I made a different implementation based on this technical report, and the basic thing is that you can decide if you're going to split your space in 1, 2, or 3 dimensions, and you select how many planes according to how many objects are cut. So you say, okay, I'm going to cut in this way. How many objects I'm splitting in half? Okay, 1%. Oh, that's okay. I can have this 1% over here and keep it there. And see? Oh, sorry. Okay. So you can and say, okay, I'm going to split this here. How many objects do I touch? Okay, you touch only 1%. Oh, that's okay. I see how I handle that 1%. On the other hand, say, okay, how many planes do I cut? How many objects do I cut? Okay, 80%. Okay, that's not possible. So I'm just not splitting this way. So I'm turning an oak tree into a quad tree and maybe just a binary tree if in 2 of the splits I'm cutting many objects. And, of course, there's a threshold there to decide that. The other thing that changes is that you can compute what is the center, what you're going to use to split. In the original case, you say, okay, I'm taking this cube and taking the center, and here I put the 3 planes. And in this case, okay, I can move this dynamically to see what fits better. And there are many, heuristics like saying, okay, use the center, take the median of the center of all the bounding boxes, and you can play with many strategies to do that. Oops. And the other thing that changes is that now what it is that okay, what happens to this 1% of objects that are being cut by the split? So the split say, okay, this half goes to that branch, this half goes to that branch, and by this split that is cutting this 1%, I'm keeping them here in the intermediate node. So the ideal thing is to have all your nodes in the leaves, but if you are doing really small quantity of objects, you can put in the nodes, and I'm showing you how you render them. So basically, what you're saying here is that when you have to render a scene, basically a tree, if the self box here is the bounding box of the node that you're standing on, if I contain the, sorry? Okay. If this box contains the camera position, then if it doesn't, what I'm going to do is to check the intersection between bounding boxes, okay? And if they intersect, if they don't intersect, then I just can, you know, skip it. I mean, this is my node, I have my bounding box, I have the bounding box of an object. If there's no intersection, then I just can throw it away and there's no problem. And then, on the other hand, what can happen is that they do intersect, so then I check against the kind of intersection that I have with the frustum using the old technique. And if the object is completely inside the frustum of the camera, that means that all this, the objects that are inside this node will be inside, because you know the node encompasses all the objects in the bounding box. So basically what I'm saying is, okay, render all your childs, but don't check anything, because I know that they will be all inside of the frustum. And if it intersects, then I'm going to do another stuff. And if they're outside, I don't have to do anything. So the default thing to do in the case, you know, there is just a common intersection that I cannot say render them all without checking or don't render them, is to render all the objects that are in this node. As I told you, nodes can have objects. And then to continue with your childs. So basically, this basic algorithm with some few changes can be applied both to this dynamic axis aligned bounding box tree and the R trees. So what do we get here? Okay. First of all, 20 scavenges. The best thing was 12, and we get to 20, but it's not that bad. If you take that, it takes only 1.38 seconds, which is about 145 frame per second. If you recall from the previous slide, the best that we achieved was around 35 frames per second. And if you see the portion of the scene that we're actually seeing, this makes sense because that was looking at a little bit less than 1/4 of the entire scene. So we kind of get this 4x time speed up. And now, most of the time is done on rendering primitives and the rest of intersection stuff. And using the R-tree for the same case gives the double scavenges, and it takes more time. It's about 27 frames per second. But the interesting thing here is that the absolute time for rendering the primitives is almost the same, which, you know, makes sense because both should do the work of removing all the objects that are not inside your frustum, and so the time, the absolute time you spend rendering them should be the same. And of course, R3 is you know, it takes more time. However, if we use the same scene, but instead of saying I have this complete scene, and you just render them, and you add one by one the stuff. Basically, what shows here is that the R-tree outperforms the dynamic ABB tree. And that has to do with the fact that the dynamic tree is using 75% of the time to be traversed, because we get a really, really, really unbalanced tree. So you can compare here the amount of nodes. You have only 908 against this amount of internal nodes. So we get a really unbalanced tree, which now takes too long to be rendered. So basically two things: that if we keep adding objects which are outside the field of view, then we almost get no penalty in times, which again is logical because the objects are outside, and since I'm using a tree, I'm expecting to remove them really quickly. And on the other hand, if we put the objects inside, then my times are doubling. So basically, the collection is not a way, it's not an option. Our trees are good to handling dynamic scenes, so I can add and remove stuff in between. But once I have my scene fixed, then I can convert it to an ABB tree. And so I get, you know, this pass on these two worlds. So the time you have to pay for faster rendering is that, well, you have time to build scenes, and in memory, you get this overhead. So just one, two things. Finally, in general, you don't expect the programmer to program all the models, so you use models that are built with, you know, tools from the outside. So basically, .objects are a format to read objects that is done in a pretty much human-readable format. So I create a parser for it, and I can show you this over here. Shall we? So basically, what you got here is this object read from the outside, and it has all different stuff. And well, I was going to show you Spectrum, but I have no time, so I guess I can just do this. And basically, just one thing I want to say of how important I think that this conference is because last year I had a talk about Leandro implementing instance-based behavior, and that kind of gave me the idea when I was facing a problem to actually do it. And I implemented that in VisualWorks. And Leandro, if you want later, we can talk about it because I got this kind of verification stuff going on that may be useful. But I really found this thing of being here and sharing stuff kind of, you know, really cool for sharing things. And I have this lightweight browser and whatever. So there are many things to do. I'm not going to bore you with this because this is really, really very simple engine. There are many, many things to do. But, you know, yesterday I was wondering, and I say, okay, what have I done here? And actually, I have done nothing because I only copy giants. I mean, I'm not standing on their shoulders to look, you know, behind me to do more important stuff. So all this stuff is really, most of it, except maybe for the tree part, there are things that are well known in the community. So, you know, it's kind of giving the feeling of, you know, in a way I'm proud of it, but in a way I think it's kind of crap because, you know, I'm not doing anything new. So I guess that, I don't know, somehow things had to be, you know, rethink again and I don't know, just change them. So thank you, and sorry for the delay. So I don't think we have time for questions, so... Okay, go ahead.
So that's so it does not create points.
Well, actually, the points are already created because you know the bounding boxes are there in the object. In the object caches them, and on the other. Oh yeah, I've been doing different weird stuff. Yeah, sure. Yeah, I'm avoiding creating objects, and yeah. And if you see the code, it's actually kind of scary.